Learn from top professors on the road or in your home with Learn 25.
Jamie Pope is a leading expert on nutrition and an assistant professor at Vanderbilt University. The textbook she co-authored, Nutrition for a Changing World, is used by more than 140 universities across the United States. Beyond the classroom, she adapted portions of her nutrition courses into a massive open online course, attracting more than 175,000 participants from around the world and earning her an Innovation in Teaching Award. Professor Pope is a fellow of the Academy of Nutrition and Dietetics and the co-author of several popular press books, including The T-Factor Fat Gram Counter, which remained on the New York Times bestseller list for more than 3 years. She has authored or contributed to numerous scientific and popular press publications. Professor Pope has also served in several corporate positions as a nutrition consultant and media representative.
Topic 1, Navigating Nutrition, Introduction. Welcome to Nutrition 101. I'm Jamie Pope, a registered dietitian nutritionist and longtime nutrition professor at Vanderbilt University in Nashville, Tennessee. I'm also co-author of the introductory nutrition textbook, Nutrition for a Changing World, with my colleague and friend, nutrition biochemist, Dr. Stephen Nazilski. The education, experiences, and opportunities over the years have combined to keep me abreast of developments in my field, but also keep me humble in regards to how much there is to know and keep up with across the very diverse and evolving field of nutrition. Over my 40-plus years in the field of nutrition, I've seen advances in knowledge and a growing appreciation of the role of diet in our health, in disease prevention, and in aging well. I've also seen numerous trends, approaches, and recommendations, many of which come and go. Others have made the test of time and evidence. Being a nutrition professional isn't always easy. Few areas in the health sciences are so fraught with debate, discourse, and confusion. Confusion for the public and for health professionals alike. In the public arena, nutrition seems to be as much a belief system as a science. I've found that people often have very entrenched opinions about food and dietary approaches that might be based in sound nutrition science and research, but may also stem from something they read or heard in the media, found online, or were told by a friend or family member. Studies show that while most people trust health professionals as a source of credible information and advice, most of their information comes from internet searches, news stories, friends, and even social media. In my introductory nutrition course at Vanderbilt, a primary goal for my students, and now for you, is to leave the course as better consumers, able to better evaluate what you read, what you hear in the media, or see on products in the marketplace, against what's sound and current scientific evidence. I want them, my students, and you, to question the many nutrition-related claims that you read or hear about and consider more than just a headline or a claim on a food or supplement label. I hope my students, whether in the classroom or as part of this course, have a better grasp of foundational nutrition concepts and terms. Terms they've likely heard, but might not understand the implications of or context within a healthy diet. For example, before trans fats were banned, and we'll talk about those later in the course, I would show my students two cracker boxes that both contained so-called butter crackers, except one said no trans fats on the front of the box. When asked which they would buy if they were priced the same, students almost unanimously said the one declaring no trans fats. I then asked a room of over 180 students if someone could tell me what trans fats were and the benefit of a no trans fat product. Only one student was brave enough to raise their hand and say, "I just know they're bad for you." Yes, in fact, just 1% of total calories from trans fat increases the risk of heart disease through its impact on blood cholesterol. But as we'll learn, trans fats are created when an oil is made more solid by a chemical process called partial hydrogenation, changing the configuration of the fatty acid. And much to my students' surprise, butter has no trans fat, but more on that and other topics later. I assume that since you decided to listen to a course on nutrition, that you have an interest in nutrition, food, and health. It is indeed an interesting area of study and application, but it's challenging as well. Nutrition is a young and evolving science with new research coming out constantly that might validate previous theories or give pause for another perspective. No wonder the public gets confused and frustrated with mixed messages and sometimes even reversal of previous recommendations. I hope this course will help provide a foundation to better understand terms and concepts and provide tools and strategies to help you sift through the changing information that bombards us each day when we turn on our computers or the TV or even gather with friends. I'm not going to give you my personal opinions in this course. Rather, I will hopefully translate and share current evidence and knowledge in nutrition science. I do have my own perspectives and beliefs about nutrition and health, but these are grounded in what scientific literature, nutrition scientists, and credible health organizations publish for professionals and the public. For many questions in nutrition, and new questions arise constantly, they're not always concrete answers. For most, the best and only answer is to say, based on current evidence, or what we know to date, or even evidence is inconclusive and more research is warranted. I often tell my students that I address questions, not necessarily answer them, as a firm answer in nutrition would usually be preceded with the qualifier, it depends. An important point before we get started. This course is to provide information and to share about the science and scope of nutrition. It's not intended to give individualized advice. Although I'll share dietary recommendations from a variety of credible sources and health organizations, these are written with populations in mind, not necessarily specific individuals. It's important that you discuss any significant dietary or health behavior change with your healthcare provider. And if you have health or medical conditions for which diet plays a role in managing, it's advisable to consult with a registered dietitian nutritionist in your area. Tweaks and improvements don't necessarily translate to an overhaul in how you eat. I was recently struck by the philosophy of a former White House chef who wasn't a fan of telling people to eat right, rather to eat better. I applaud and echo that sentiment. Eating better can mean just some small changes or substitutions or additions in how we eat and a few of the dozens of food choices we make each day that can add up over time to improve dietary quality and overall health. Now, I found my way into the field of nutrition as a result of a high school English assignment. We were told to design and conduct a survey within the student body and to then write up the implications of that survey. At a loss as what to investigate, I chose what students ate for lunch. At the time, our school, now this was in the 70s, didn't have a true cafeteria. Rather, students brought their lunch or they bought meals from vending machines that offered sandwiches and soups, along with sweet and salty snack-type foods. Students that brought their lunches often also bought a snack or two from the vending machines. I found in my survey that the two most commonly purchased foods were Cheetos and Milky Way bars. In writing up the implications of my survey, I realized that wasn't so great as daily choices. I'd never considered vitamins or minerals or that we needed a certain amount each day for health, growth, and well-being. I looked at my mom's dinner selections of a protein like chicken or a pork chop, a starch like potatoes or rice, a vegetable side, a roll, and the classic 70s fruit cocktail in a new light. Variety, several groups of food. Ah, there must be some rationale behind this. So a couple years later, while I was browsing the college catalog, thinking I had to pick a major, I saw a course on vitamins and another on meal management. And the rest is history, at least my personal history. In the U.S., to become a registered dietitian nutritionist, or RDN, which was formerly just called RD, or registered dietitian, one must complete an undergraduate degree from a university with an accredited program in foods, nutrition, or dietetics, and then apply for and complete a dietetic internship before taking a registration exam. Many registered dietitian nutritionists like myself also hold advanced graduate degrees, and as of 2023, a master's will be required in order to take the registration exam. There's other health professionals with advanced degrees in nutrition or medicine or health that are not RDNs, but that are qualified to evaluate and interpret nutrition science. I share this because nutrition advice is often dispensed by individuals that do not have the academic or practice experience to critically evaluate nutrition science as it applies to dietary advice. We'll take a look a bit later in the course at ways to evaluate nutrition information and consider credible sources. Over the next 16 classes, I'm going to give you a short course, an abridged version of the course I teach at Vanderbilt, plus address some current hot topics in nutrition along the way that align with the overall topic we're addressing. The accompanying course outline will help you follow along, as well as provide helpful resources and links to credible websites. We'll start the course with some of the important basics in nutrition, like carbohydrates, proteins, and fats, with an overview of the vitamins and minerals. I feel it's important to have a good grasp on terms and concepts before we pull it all together to consider just what is a healthy diet, or examine dietary supplements, plant-based diets, nutrition as we age, and other topics. We'll also address some frequently asked questions that nutrition professionals get from their students, patients, and the public. So let's get started. Let's start by defining nutrition. Nutrition encompasses not only the study of what we eat, but the behaviors that surround food choice and dietary intake, as well as the nutrients and other constituents in food and how they're used in the body and their influence on human health. Nutrition is about more than food, crossing over into a number of areas of study like agriculture, economics, chemistry, biochemistry, physiology, and psychology, to name just a few. This is one reason you might find nutrition courses offered in a variety of schools and departments at different universities. Food provides nutrients. Nutrients are chemical substances that are required for your body to function. They're needed for growth, development, reproduction, and the maintenance and repair of your body's tissues. There are certain nutrients that must be supplied through our diet to meet our needs and sustain life. We call these essential nutrients. Your body can't produce sufficient amounts to meet your body's needs, and thus you have to consume them through foods and beverages. Examples of these are vitamins, certain amino acids, and certain fatty acids. Some nutrients found in food can also be manufactured by the body in amounts to meet our needs, and thus are sometimes called non-essential nutrients. Although this term can be misleading, because even though the non-essential nutrients, or those we don't have to consume through food to meet our needs, are also essential to the functions of our bodies and to our health. These include, among others, cholesterol and certain amino acids. For example, while our bodies require cholesterol for a variety of vital functions, your liver produces cholesterol in sufficient amounts to meet your needs. Because cholesterol is found only in animal foods, individuals who eliminate all animal foods, like vegans, would still have sufficient cholesterol to fulfill body functions. There are six classes of essential nutrients in human nutrition. All six classes of nutrients are involved in numerous body processes, and most supply the building blocks of key body structures, such as cell membranes, muscles, and bones. They include carbohydrates, proteins, fats, which is a subclass of lipids, vitamins, minerals, and water. Carbohydrates, fats, protein, and water are considered macronutrients because they're required in large amounts by the body. Fats refer to triglycerides, one of the chemical classes of lipids. With the exception of water, the macronutrients supply energy to fuel your body's processes and make up a large portion of the structural components of our body. The energy in food is measured in kilocalories, or more commonly referred to as just calories. Calories are a measurement, not a component of food. We'll talk more about calories and our caloric needs later in the course. Micronutrients include vitamins and minerals. They're required in small amounts in the body and are not a source of energy, but are required to utilize the energy of the macronutrients. In order to utilize the nutrients in food, the process of digestion breaks food down, extracting macronutrients and micronutrients, as well as other constituents in food. such as the beneficial, biologically active phytochemicals found in many plant foods. We'll explore phytochemicals when we address plant-based diets. Once broken down into their smallest units, carbohydrates into simple sugars like glucose, protein into amino acids, and fats into fatty acids, they're absorbed and put to work or stored in the body. Vitamins and minerals are extracted during digestion and are then absorbed and utilized as needed by the body. We all have specific nutrient needs based on a variety of factors like stage of life, demands of growth and development, and gender. In the U.S., to help meet our nutrient needs and choose the foods that create a healthful diet, an expert committee of the Health and Medical Division, formerly the Institute of Medicine, of the National Academy of Sciences, evaluates evidence and provides guidance on health and science policy. They issue what are termed dietary reference intakes, or DRI values. Now, bear with me for a few minutes as we talk about the DRI values, because I'll be referring to these acronyms later in the course. DRIs are estimates of nutrient intakes that are used to plan and assess diets for healthy people. They're intended to meet the needs of 97 to 98% of all healthy people across the lifespan. The DRI values help us avoid nutrient deficiency, as well as establish nutrient intake levels that promote our health, prevent disease, and avoid adverse effects by consuming too much. While we haven't established it for all nutrients, what's considered too much is called the tolerable upper intake level, or UL. Usually, this is used in reference to vitamins and minerals. The UL represents the highest amount of a specific nutrient that most people can consume daily without causing any harm. Interestingly, this is an area of concern when you consider that people consume nutrients not only through food, but through food products that have been fortified with additional vitamins and minerals, and potentially through dietary supplements. When you combine all three sources, you can see it might be possible to overconsume certain nutrients over time. You can find information about your own dietary reference intake values by visiting the Food and Nutrition Information Center of the U.S. Department of Agriculture. I've included the link in the accompanying course outline that includes suggested websites and resources. You can also find this resource by searching DRI Calculator. While designed for health professionals, you can enter in your information on your age, height, weight, and activity level, and you can find out recommended intakes for macronutrients and micronutrients, as well as sources and information on all the individual nutrients by clicking on that nutrient's name. This might be a valuable resource to refer to throughout the course. An important value within the RDAs is likely one you've heard about, the RDA, or Recommended Dietary Allowance. It's established to meet or exceed the requirements of nearly all, that's about 98%, of healthy people. The DRIs also include a value called the AI, or Adequate Intake, which is based on research or observation of the amount of a nutrient individuals typically need to be healthy, but for which we don't have sufficient evidence or there's too many variables to consider to generate an actual RDA. Water, fiber, and some of the vitamins and minerals have AIs rather than RDAs. I just want you to have some understanding of these acronyms when they're used later in the course. The DV, or daily value, you see on food labels is an adaptation of the RDA and AI's exclusive use on food labels. We'll also be taking a closer look at food labels a bit later in the course. Putting the DRI values together gives a more complete picture of each nutrient. For example, intake between the RDA, which is considered the minimum you need, and the UL, or the maximum, for a nutrient is likely adequate and safe for most people. Too much or too little of a nutrient, based on the DRIs, is associated with increased risk of adverse effects. Inadequacy or nutrient deficiency with intake below the RDA, especially over time, and increased risk of nutrient toxicity with intakes over the UL. As more research evidence becomes available, DRIs are revised and revisited. but the DRIs are a challenge to translate into actual food choice, numbers into what we actually put on our plate. In my Vanderbilt class, my students complete an online analysis of 3 days of their intake. The average nutrient intake of those 3 days can then be compared to their established DRIs, and they can see where they might fall short or go above for certain nutrients. Usually, across the board, students are low in vitamin D and potassium, and females also in iron and calcium, and most are over in the mineral sodium. We'll get beyond the numbers to actual food when we consider the characteristics and different types of healthy diets later in the course. An imbalance in macronutrient intake, particularly of fat and carbohydrate, can also increase the risk of several chronic diseases. For example, high protein diets often translate to high fat diets, and often less than healthy fats, and carbohydrate intake that's lower than recommended. We'll be looking at some of the popular diets that skew macronutrient intake one way or the other, the characteristics of those diets, and the potential impact on health. Based on what we know about healthful intake of carbs, protein, and fat, the DRIs also provide recommendations that are called acceptable macronutrient distribution ranges, or AMDR. These provide a healthy range of intake for carbohydrates, protein, and total fat, along with some specific types of fat expressed as a percentage of total calories. Adults can obtain adequate amounts of macronutrients when their carbohydrate intake falls between 45 and 65% of total calories. Their protein intake falls between 10 and 35% of total calories, and their fat intake is within 20 and 35%. These ranges provide some elbow room to allow for and account for differences in people's health status, disease risk, personal preferences, or dietary goals. The vast majority of my students' diet analysis results show that they typically fall within these ranges, although some were slightly above the recommended range for fat. There's a lot of variability depending on what they tend to emphasize in their food choices. Research shows that individuals who regularly eat below or above these ranges put themselves at risk of getting too few essential nutrients or of developing chronic diseases. Both the quantity and variety of nutrients in foods can promote health or increase risk of disease. Scientific research over the past 100 years or more has provided growing evidence that what we eat affects our health and risk of disease. Diet plays a role in prevention, risk, progression, and treatment of nearly every chronic disease like heart disease, stroke, cancer, obesity, and diabetes. And we're learning more about how nutrition impacts the aging process and brain health. Current evidence supports that more plant-based diets and decreased consumption of saturated fats, added sugars, and sodium will help decrease risk. We'll be discussing more about how food choices and our overall eating behavior can help protect us from chronic disease and potentially add years to our lives. This concludes our first class together, in which we've done a flyover of the science of nutrition, the essential nutrients, the dietary reference intake values, and the role of diet and disease. In the next classes, we'll begin to look at each of the 6 classes of essential nutrients, including the macronutrients, carbohydrates, fats, and protein, and then an overview of the vitamins, minerals, and water. After this foundation, we'll pull it together to consider components and characteristics of healthy diets. And I purposely use the plural, healthy diets, because there's not just one healthy way to eat. We'll then consider some topics that are of interest in the media and represent frequently asked questions about nutrition and specific foods or nutrients. At the end of each class in this course, I'll be suggesting a short and relevant homework assignment to help personalize and apply the information we cover. For this class, I suggest that you visit the Food and Nutrition Information Center of the U.S. Department of Agriculture for that DRI calculator. You can Google DRI calculator, and it should be one of the first search results. The link's also on the course informational outline. Enter your information to generate a table listing your recommendations for energy intake, macronutrient intake, vitamins, and minerals. You can print or save this table to refer to during the course. Thank you for your interest and for taking this course on nutrition. I look forward to exploring nutrition together. Topic 2, Carbohydrates, Friend or Foe, Part 1. Welcome to class number 2 of Nutrition 101. In this class, we're going to introduce the macronutrient carbohydrate and talk about what are considered simple carbohydrates. The term carbohydrates or carbs likely makes you crave or cringe, and they're often villainized as a cause of weight gain or seen as a supreme indulgence. I hope to provide background and an update on carbohydrates, why your body needs them to thrive, the variety of ways they're available to us, and ways to emphasize higher quality carbohydrates. While we'll start with carbohydrates, we're going to also cover the macronutrients fat and protein in upcoming classes. We're going to look at two ways carbohydrates are classified, simple and complex. Simple include the sugars, not just added sugar in a soda or a cookie, but the naturally occurring sugars in milk and fruits. And complex carbs, which include starches and fiber. In this class and the next, we're going to look at the science regarding the role of both classes of carbohydrate in health and disease. Plus, we're going to consider evidence-based recommendations for healthy carbohydrate intake. You likely recall the term photosynthesis from your high school biology class. Essentially, plants capture the energy of sunlight and convert it into chemical energy in the form of carbohydrates, namely starch. Thus, aside from dairy foods, only plant foods provide significant sources of carbohydrate. We need carbohydrates, and they have many important roles in our body, in nutrition and in health. Carbs are our primary and generally preferable source of energy for all our body's cells. Our brain, red blood cells, and exercising muscles thrive on energy from carbohydrates. When you eat a varied diet, carbohydrates reduce the use of protein for energy. In other words, sufficient intake of carbohydrates to meet your energy needs allows protein to do its job in our bodies, tissues' growth, maintenance, and repair. Carbohydrate foods are also the only source of fiber in the diet, and they contribute sweetness and flavor to food. Chemically, carbohydrates are made up of carbon, hydrogen, and oxygen. However, carbohydrates are not created equal. They differ in their quality in terms of nutrient content and how they might influence our health. Carbohydrates are composed of one or more sugar units or molecules, and based on the number of sugar units, are classified as simple or complex. Simple carbohydrates, or sugars, are made up of just one or two sugar units and are found in added sugars, syrups, fruits, many vegetables, and in milk and milk products. Complex carbohydrates, like starches and fiber, are found in grains, beans, legumes, and some vegetables. Just a bit of chemistry here. Simple carbohydrates include what are termed mono, or one, saccharides, or sugar, or di, two, saccharides. Glucose, fructose, and galactose are monosaccharides. When linked together, two monosaccharides make up a disaccharide. We don't find the monosaccharide glucose solo in our food, but it's the most abundant monosaccharide in our diet. That's because it's part of the disaccharide like sucrose, often known as table sugar, which is made up of glucose and fructose, and lactose, which is milk sugar, made up of the monosaccharides glucose and galactose. In the U.S., added sugars comprise about 15% of our daily calorie intake, adding up to about 300 calories a day from added sugar, with some differences across age groups. Sugar-sweetened beverages like soda, fruit drinks, and sports and energy drinks contribute almost half of our added sugar intake, followed by processed snacks and sweets and baked goods. Possibly because of sugar's negative press and public health messages, recent evidence does indicate that intake of added sugars, even among youth, is gradually declining. Added sugars is a term you'll see on the newly introduced version of the food label in the U.S., which we'll navigate in a later class. That includes sugars or syrups added to foods during preparation or processing. It doesn't include naturally occurring sugars found in fruits, some vegetables, and dairy foods. When you eat a food with sugar in it, regardless of the type of sugar, quote, natural or added, your body breaks the food down and uses sugar for energy. Sometimes it uses that energy right away, while other times it stores it to use later. Some naturally occurring sugars are found in healthful foods. For example, dairy foods contain a form of sugar called lactose, which we'll discuss a bit later, but dairy foods also provide protein, calcium, and vitamin D. Fruits and vegetables may contain a variety of natural sugars, but they also provide dietary fiber, vitamins, minerals, and antioxidants. Grains provide some naturally occurring sugars, but they also provide vitamins and minerals, and many whole grains are good sources of dietary fiber and may provide additional nutrients too. Added sugars are primarily used to enhance the taste of food, but they also are used to improve appearance, texture, and even shelf life of foods. Added sugars come in many forms. On ingredient lists, you'll see different names of sugar like brown sugar, invert sugar, corn syrup, malt syrup, maple syrup, concentrated fruit juice, honey, molasses, or dextrose. High fructose corn syrup certainly got its share of media attention in the past decades. It differs slightly from sucrose or table sugar in that it contains slightly more fructose, 55% versus 50%, with the remainder as glucose. While all sorts of claims abound, the actual implications of this difference really remains unclear. The best advice is to moderate intake of added sugars, whatever the source. A student once gave me a bottle of agave nectar, telling me her mother had replaced all sugars with this healthy alternative. No evidence really demonstrates this, and it's interesting to note that indeed it is really high fructose corn syrup with close to 80% fructose. Bottom line, they're all essentially added sugar. With the same caloric contribution of 4 calories per gram of weight and essentially no nutrient contributions. 1 teaspoon of table sugar, for example, contains 4 grams of carbohydrate or 16 calories. That doesn't really sound like much unless you consider that nutrition surveys estimate Americans consume on average about 17 teaspoons a day, or about 270 calories, with some surveys reporting even higher levels of intake. So what's the issue with added sugars? They increase energy density of food, or the number of calories per given volume or amount of food, and they can decrease nutrient density, or the concentration of nutrients. Sugars are often overconsumed, which can contribute to excessive calorie intake, which increases risk of development and maintenance of obesity. In addition, consider these points. Foods with added sugars are generally poor sources of nutrients. Point 2, emphasis on foods and beverages with added sugars may displace more nutrient-dense foods. Also, added sugars do little to promote satiety or feeling satisfied between meals and snacks. Many foods high in added sugar are also high in fat and total calories, and thus they may contribute to positive energy balance or consuming more calories than we might require to maintain a healthy weight. Also, there's increased likelihood that overall intake will be insufficient in vitamins and minerals with higher levels of added sugar intake. We also know that consumption of sweets or foods high in added sugars promotes tooth decay, especially stickier sweets that have longer exposure time to your teeth. For example, marshmallows, taffy, jelly beans are all more likely to promote cavities than, say, even a cookie. The Dietary Guidelines for Americans advise keeping added sugars to less than 10% of your calories in order to avoid or reduce risk of some of these effects. There are many claims about the perils of added sugar, but as with most areas in nutrition, one can't focus on just one dietary component as the root cause of health issues. Recent systematic reviews and meta-analysis have further examined the relationship of added sugar intake and chronic disease risk factors. While it's wise to moderate intake of added sugars, intake within current recommended levels does not appear to cause a unique risk for diabetes, heart disease, or even obesity. So what is a safe range of added sugar intake? As noted, the Dietary Guidelines for Americans, intended for those 2 years of age and over, for the first time in 2015, included a specific ceiling for sugar consumption of less than 10% of total calories. Earlier guidelines said eat less or moderate, but didn't give specific levels because there just wasn't sufficient data to set a ceiling for sugar intake. As noted, surveys show that Americans consume about 15% of their calories from added sugar. So for a 2,000-calorie diet, the 10% ceiling would be less than 200 calories from added sugar versus the 300 calories or more we consume now. The 10% ceiling is echoed by the World Health Organization, with further recommendation that less than even 5% of calories from added sugar can provide additional health benefits. The American Heart Association supports this additional reduction, recommending that women consume less than 100 calories a day from added sugars, and men less than 150 calories a day, closer to that 5% of total calories. This translates to about 6 teaspoons equivalent of added sugars for women and about 9 teaspoons for men. Consider that a 12-ounce regular soda provides about 10 teaspoons of added sugar, and a large cafe mocha about that or more. Nicely, the new food labels singles out added sugar in grams in food products. The American Heart Association also recommends a specific limit for added sugars for children, age 2 to 18, of 6 teaspoons or about 25 grams per day. That's the same level recommended not to exceed for women. Current evidence and evidence-based recommendations allow some room for sweet treats and added sugars within an overall balanced, varied, and adequate diet. Granted, when choosing carbohydrate foods, it makes sense to opt for less processed and more nutrient-dense, higher-quality carbohydrate foods like vegetables, whole grains, beans, legumes, and whole fruits. Despite popular beliefs, sugar is not considered addictive in the classic sense, but it's certainly appealing to our taste buds and even appetites. A recent study in the Journal of the Academy of Nutrition and Dietetics underscored our biological preference for sweet-tasting foods, and said that attempts to reduce sugar intake can be challenging, in part because as people intentionally avoided sugar-sweetened foods and beverages, the reinforcing value of those foods increased. In other words, they wanted them more. Some claim the addictive quality may be rooted in restriction and avoidance, and that this restraint is the gateway, so to speak, of wanting or being prone to overindulgence. We want what we deny ourselves. And when faced with the opportunity to indulge, it becomes almost a biological and probably a psychological urge to do so. I recall being along with a group of Girl Scouts to a local outlet mall where we had coupons for free cinnamon rolls. One of the young girl's mothers was rather diligent and strict about her children's having foods with sugar or white flour. Well-intentioned, I'm sure, but this can sometimes go a bit too far. Well, we didn't feel it was fair to exclude this child from having a free cinnamon roll. They were huge, and most of the girls ate only about half and rather slowly at that, focusing on socializing. This child ate rapidly and finished the entire roll and then took the container that it was placed in and began licking any extra icing. She hadn't really learned how to enjoy sweet treats now and then and do so in moderation. This journal article recommended a gradual reduction in sugar intake towards recommended intake levels rather than an abrupt change, and that substituting naturally sweet foods like fresh fruit might help. Keep colorful, fresh, and varied foods available and accessible, and emphasize foods that nourish your body. I'm not a believer in restriction, but choice guided by our body's needs and the pleasure of eating to sustain our bodies and enjoy those around us. It's important to realize that added sugar does not directly cause obesity or diabetes, but can contribute to excess calorie intake, compromised diet quality, and potentially have metabolic implications that increase risk. In the U.S., it appears we're very gradually reducing intake of added sugars, but we're not necessarily eating overall healthier diets. So, what are some ways to moderate added sugar? For many, cutting back or even avoiding sugar-sweetened beverages can go a long way. I had a weight management client a few years ago that was drinking at least 2 of the 2-liter size of regular Pepsi or Mountain Dew a day.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.